Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for the introduction. It is a really pleasure to be again here in my country, surrounded by my friends and colleagues from the conference, since I remember Nigel, maybe this from the second conference together. And I thank you, Jerry, for keeping the wonderful level of the conference, especially, I don't know how you feel, but I feel that this particular conference has is very, very high level. And things are coming to the puzzle, is, as Nigel said. it's thanks to everybody, so we develop, obviously. Thanks to the water, maybe. So, people already try to pronounce aquaphotomics as not aquaphotonics. In Japanese, M and N sound are the same, so I don't mind. But in English, M and N are different. So we talk about aquaphotomics. And omics stands for all about interaction between light and water. So I'll give you basic slides about this for newcomers. The idea of aquaphotomics is actually to look at the water as a collective mirror of matter and energy. Why I came up with this idea? Because I found out that the healthy state of biological system and the sick is highly related to the water structure. And this paradox which we have in the contemporary science of being reductionist and going after each and single molecule and trying to, and using all destructive methods that do not allow, unfortunately, to get to the functionality by looking simultaneously in the four dimension of time to all of elements we have. So I proposed aquaphotomics as a holistic approach, because water behaves as a mirror, behaving as a mirror, as a collective mirror, has all the information about other molecules. And here the technology comes. So if we have a technology that could do non-invasive, non-destructive monitoring of water, aqueous systems and biological systems, then we can learn a lot about what is going on and how water exactly is involved in processes in timescale of femto, okay, let's say milliseconds. Many people here say that water is the stage, and so aquaphotomics describes the environment, the stage, and that is why water spectral pattern could be a holistic marker directly related to functionalities. Now, I will talk about a little bit about this electromagnetic spectrum, particularly this part, because I've been using all the infrared light, which is very good for non-invasive, non-destructive, real-time measurements, which is the point of the whole presentation, how much we can see using that technique, and vice versa, by what we see, how much we can learn about water. And because I'm going to talk this time about not only analyzing the systems with spectral patterns, but also paying attention to the fact that when we measure the spectra, we actually induce a perturbation and we are changing the system. And thanks God that increase information, but at the same time, it has also an effect on the system and we can see it. that's why I'm giving the spectra of the sun, in the intensity spectra of the sunlight, half of which is an infrared light, and we still ask, in the presentation I'll try to lead you to think about having near-infrared bands, which we found specific frequencies. This time we talk a lot about coherence and frequencies. Using specific frequencies in this particular near-infrared range as possibilities to earn a feedback to our systems. Not only to use this light as a probe to get response from the system, but also to use this light to invade the system and influence the system. And just to have, again, an idea, you have seen already the spectra this time. Here is the near-infrared, and I will show you how it looks in the range of 680 nanometers to 2500 nanometers. I will go this time in details talking about the first overtone of stretching vibrations of the water, and I would like to emphasize on the fact that this is an overtone. I will show some results about the second overtone and the third as well. But have in mind that the overtone spectroscopy is a nonlinear spectroscopy, which gives lots of more information than in infrared itself. Now, I'll get back to the idea of having, of course, water as a main object in the system, perturbing the system by measuring it also with infrared. And of course, water has been investigated with X-ray and UV and all the whole electromagnetic spectrum. But this particular part of the spectrum allows us to do non-invasive studies and go into deep into the coherence, understanding the coherence and interaction of molecular species in the water. But for that particular purpose, so what we need a spectral analysis, a multivariate analysis of the spectral data to extract the specific water matrix coordinates, I call them, those are the specific water frequencies that come to be so important, not only as a hub of information, but probably in a next step as a source of perturbations of feedback that we can use to influence the system. And of course, it's non-destructive and leading to directly to functionality studies that opens up lots of possible application. And I'll try to talk about this technology as a source of going to different areas in different fields. Now, just one example how we do this. This is a cluster of 21 water molecules, protonated cluster. Just to show you, this is an infrared study where all bands are identified, assigned. So we have hydronium atom here, we have DDA stretching AAD. So all these bands assigned in infrared could be calculated in infrared, and we experimentally prove these bands. Now, this is one calculation that we did recently. These bands are one of the 12 bands that we found out under the first overtone of the water. And they are, the ratio between them follows exactly the tone ratios with the base C. That was very interesting. These are the 12 bands. Sorry for the small, but this is a different system that we found all these water bands. You will see them lately. These are the instruments that we have been using until now, portable devices and laboratory devices. This is the last one that we showed at this exhibition for the first time. And I'm very proud in a way to tell you that this device have been made by a group of people that have been my students in Bulgaria before I went to Japan. So I'll talk about Aquagram because Aquagram is a graph that represents this specific water bands, specific frequency that we have found. And now, from now on, please follow me with this. This is the aquagram representing the spectra of the water vapor and just the bulk water. Now, we know that water vapor is used for cooking and is very aggressive, and it is working. So I call this part of this is the first overtone. These are the 12 water bands under the first overtone of the water. And each of those has, for example, this band, 1364 nanometers, is related to water solvation shell. This is the stretching vibration, asymmetric and symmetric. And this is a these are protonated clusters. This is a trapped these are trapped water molecules, free but not free because they're trapped between ions. So this here is hydronium. And these are the dimer, trimer, tetramer, pentamer, and hydrogen bonded structures. So you can understand that this part, as I call it, working water, and this part, the water batteries, this in between is working a kind of regulator, will be very important. So I will start with a very basic experiments that we've been doing in my lab and recently repeating with in our joint experiment with Luc Montagnier in the lab, trying to understand the dilutions. So I'll try to cover a few keywords that have been in this room since yesterday and the other day. So what happened to a millicule water when we start taking spectra? We did three replicates, three repeats at 25 degrees temperature, and we took 15 consecutive spectra. After we incubate the sample for 2 minutes. Now, these are the three replicates, 1, 2, 3. This is the temperature, because we measure the temperature of the water in the cell after incubation of 2 minutes, after taking the spectra. This is the first measurement, second, these are the consecutive spectra. So you see that the temperature changes, but the temperature actually fluctuates. And this is the distribution of the temperature. Now, I subtract the first spectrum, and these are the subtracted spectrum. And this is how it is, all these ripples we can see the second spectrum, the third measurement, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth, are here in between. These are the free water molecules, these are the hydrogen bonded water structure. Why this picture is important because, and this is the aquagram. So we have high temperature here, working water, low temperature here, water batteries. Now, if we change another experiment, millicule water used, we change the temperature from 20 to 74 every 2 degrees, nearly the same protocol. These are the spectra. You don't see, to see better, we don't have a point, an isospacing really point. We have a plateau, a kind of non-linear changes here. This is the second derivative. So this is the specificity of the second overtone. When we change this temperature, 20, 30, 40, 50 degrees, you see that this is the low temperature and this is the high temperature. So with but we have difference here and here when we compare this, no, I didn't do it. But if we compare the last two aquagrams, we have increased of the temperature in the room between 25, 26, and here is larger range of the temperature, and this is how the aquagrams look like. They go from, and this is all the assignment that I just want to notice that to show the working part of the aquagrams are related to hydroxylated water clusters, mostly superoxides, free water molecules. And then when we go to hydrogen bonded, of course we have hydroxylated clusters, but we have lots of protonated clusters in this part of the spectrum. Now, if we calculate the standard deviation of this of the optical density, the absorbance, you could see beautiful two faces, actually, beautifully. Two part, and this is the isospecific point, which is the hydronium. And this tells us a lot. It is very close to the water dimer, and which is related to tunneling. Now, following the conversation about coherence, and these are our calculations in this experiment about coherence and fractality following the Pipino's formula. So we have a high correlation coefficient between the log of the temperature and optical density, but negative here in the longer wavelengths, which means hydrogen bonded structures, and these are less hydrogen bonded structures, shorter range, positive correlation. Remember, I think Elia talked about the negative and positive relation between pH and electroconductivity, similar. And now I'll do this just to follow. We'll start with, this is only millicure. Now we use the same millicure is filtered with 450 nanometers filter. Did you find the difference? Yes. And now we filter with 220 nanometer filter. We have a difference. We have difference here. We have shorter ranges here and even here. So we have changed the coherence domains. And we can see it, we can measure it. Now, we measured the influence of the vortexing time and how the water structure changes with the vortexing. So you can see this in the aquagrams. These are the three replicates, I mean, three different experiments. And you could see that we have both. It's a very non-linear system. But what we found out that in all the experiments that we did, the 15 seconds, which actually Jean Benveniste and Luc Montagnier used in the experiments, is the only time of vortexing when we got this working water all the time in all the experiments. Now, of course, we measured the time after vortexing. Do we keep the same structure? For how long we keep the same structure? And we found also, it is also different structures, like working waters or hydrogen bonded water structures. Now, dilutions. We did, these are the results of 22 consecutive dilutions. The first dilution is always breaking hydrogen bonds, but then continue the dilutions, we get hydrogen bonded water, and again back, and again. It's beautiful, so I didn't want to put more slides about this, but we tried to make a PLS regression model to measure if we could see correlation between the spectra and the number of the dilution. and we did not succeed. It is absolutely non-linear, but with periodicity, with beautiful periodicity, so we could see it. Now I'll show you how this certain structure we all know, and this is isospastic structure, in water, imposed in water, at different concentrations will change the water structure, and we can measure. Now this is fullerene. This is fullerene with the water. I'm getting with the water shell on the surface, fullerol. Now, this this is very low concentration, 0.0025 microgram per milliliter, and this is the aquagram representing the water structure. So we have this hydronium here, tetrabuton. We have protonated water and protonated again and protonated again. We don't have this trapped water. And then we diluted twice, I mean the second fold, and you see how this changes. So we increase the dilution again, divided by two, so this is what we get. And we go to the nearly round shape, but not round actually. This is what we don't get here. So we are close to the water, but it's not the millicure. Now, this is the nanosystem including fullerol in water. And this slide is important because I'll compare this pictogram with how this water in the cell looks like later on. Now, because we talk about technology, we can use these water absorbent bands, these water matrix coordinates, to monitor water quality without taking samples, analyzing all the elements of the water. And you could see if we add a low, very low concentration of acid, we monitor the water and it stays in three sigma interval all the time, no changes. But when we add some acid, a very low concentration, then we get out of this range. And by the spectral pattern here, it's a loading of a principal component, we can identify the pattern of acid. Then we can identify the pattern of lactose in the same manner and salt in the same manner. So you look at the pattern and you know what is the disturbance of the water quality. It's a very fast method that we use. We can use a very simple instrument to monitor the water. And these are the aquagrams related to acid salts and the previous sodium chloride. Now, because we've been talking a lot about cells and DNA, I would like to show you one of our papers about DNA. Why? Because I want you to notice that we can measure very low micromolar concentration of DNA in water. And this is the regression vector which shows that when we add DNA to the water, even in micromolar concentration, it behaves like we have increased the temperature of the system. It is the same pattern. We have increased working water. Of course, all these wiggles here talk about other structures that have changed adding DNA. But we could also identify DNA with imposed UV light and without UV light, and also seeing which of the water WOMAX water matrix coordinates have been activated. Now, this is the regression vector about the light, the UV light that we introduced to, and we made structures. We made easy zone, and this is beautifully seen here. Now, but what happens, this is the dimer, that is the result of destructed DNA, Also in micromolar, it was very difficult to measure by conventional HPLC. But the result is also inverse spectra of water, inverse structure. Now, by this work, what we understood that we could quantitatively, we can measure and predict DNA and the deformation by this light. We can even measure how much UV radiation is imposed into the water, is illuminated, and we can measure very low concentration of DNA. But, and what I said, adding DNA means that it works as we have increased the temperature. Now, just a few slides about aquaporin, because aquaporin in the cell increases the free water molecules, it speeds up the influx of free water molecules to the cell in order to probably to lead these free water molecules wherever they need to work. So how it, we can see a beautiful division between the CHO cell, which is the control, and the cells with aquaporin. And what is the difference between the aquagram? This is the aquagram of the cells with aquaporin when compared to the cell without aquaporin, which means that it's exactly what is happening. So we have increased free water molecules, solvation shell, working water available for hydration and hydrolysis water when we have aquaporin. And now when you compare this pattern with this pattern, we see similarity. So it was just very interesting to notice about fulerol. And now we talked a lot about bacteria this time, and I want to show some of our recent results. We have worked with four types of bacteria in water. Two types that develop very fast and two types that develop very slow. First thing that we understood was what, when compared, what is the water in the lag phase? What is the water structure in the lag phase? The answer is always, for all bacteria, it's always hydrogen bonded water. But when it starts, the lag phase starts, the growth, bacteria growth, then we have working water. So we have less hydrogen bonded water, lots of hydration, water solvation shells, and it continues in even the stationary cell phase, but the difference is here. So we have working water, but we have this 1474, which is a tetramer. And the tetramer is probably related to as a dimer to energy supply, so still to be developed. Now, but what we did with these four different bacteria, we wanted to do a crazy thing. So we asked the question: can we divide in the beginning? You see, if we count the cells. Not big difference, but we wanted to predict from the lux phase which of these bacteria is a fast growth bacteria or slow growth bacteria. And we asked the question, can we do this with the data from the lag phase, or it is better to do, or it is just, it is only if we use the data from log phase. And the result is beautiful. So we could see a very nice separation in both phases. But what is more interesting, I think, is this. That in the lag phase, we could say, we could identify the bacteria which will be slow developing bacteria and the one that will be fast growing bacteria. And this is the accuracy. Nearly 99, 97% of accuracy, we could in this wavelength region, we could do this separation of these two types of bacteria. And these are the wavelengths, the water matrix coordinates that are responsible. I mean, we could see protonated water clusters with four water molecules, hydroxylated water clusters with four molecules, which are common for both phases. This is the working water. We have still a lot to understand about this, but just because of the previous speaker, it was very interesting, and I was listening with a big interest. We did this. We did compare circular DNA with double-stranded DNA. We have this lambda DNA, PUC DNA, etc. These are the DNA that we compared. And when we subtracted straight DNA, we have this difference absolutely at the point of water solvation shell, free water molecules, hydrogen bonded water. So, okay, I'll speed up. And now about the instruments that we developed. This is a portable device that is aquaphotomic sensor, one of the variations that we have. But all these are in the second and third overtone of water bands here. And with this, we analyzed milk, the freshness of milk. And these are the bands that are important with the assignment. If you need this, I can. And this is the probe that we developed to just pull in the milk and take the spectra. These are the spectra. But now, just one very interesting point. You see, it's down, up, up, down. This spectrophotometer, which is now presented here, also, what we did, all the spectrophotometers take spectra from the lower wavelengths to upper wavelengths. Pay attention that actually taking the spectra means influencing the sample. And by the way we take the spectra, we can gain more information, and this is what we did. We got better results. Here are the distances between freshness of milk after milking the cow, how many days after the milking. We could see differences. These are the differences between the first day and the second, the third, the fourth. The second day and the first, third, fourth, and fifth. So you could see that if we use down-up sequence, which means that if we start with the higher wavelength, which means lower energy, we don't get a good result. So it is very important how we analyze, how we take the spectra, how we actually activate the sample with the measurement we do. Very briefly, just to show you this agenda, we took spectra of the tissue of women and men. You see difference. We're different, yes. And then before work and after work. So this is the red is before, and white is after. This is for women specifically, and this is for men specifically. It's also different. And the last of my slides, these are three people that drink the same water. And you see the green, the red, everybody has his own signature. And by this, before drinking, we have these patterns. This is A, object, subject, and O, subject. But after drinking the same water, we get similar patterns. And we get different structures of the water. So I'll finish with this, showing that lots of directions that we can go using all this technology. I will invite you to our third international conference of aquaphotomics from the 2nd to 6th of December in Japan, in Kobe. Awajishima Island, which is close to Kobe. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Rumyana, for your perfect presentation.
Thank you.
What I liked especially was your almost poetic approach in the beginning. Water is a mirror, and you showed us the reflection you found. So, are there any questions?
Many thanks, excellent presentation. I'm really happy to see that more and more measurement approach appear. The question is following, did you observe any, let's say, relationship between optical properties and electrochemical properties? Did you explore this way?
Not yet.
Not yet, but are intending to do this?
We've done briefly, but I'm not ready yet. To give it as I did today, yeah.
Okay, probably next time we can compare, yeah.
Yes, yes.
Thank you very much. Very interesting what you've done. I would like to ask if a group of people would sing together and you would take a picture with your aquaphotomics before from each of them, and after, you think they would have a similar pattern then, when they sing together the same thing in the same breath?
I haven't done this, but this year, for me, is year of sound and color. So I hope maybe next year. I want to see the influence of the color, the influence that we have, and the synchronization of all this, the sound as well, yes.
Because it creates oneness when you sing together, you know, like yeah. People feel really together. So
yes.
Maybe
it will be interesting if we can prove it, yeah.
Yeah, bye, thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead, yeah.
With your bacterial work, obviously, one possibility would be to look at bacteria as they go through their cell cycle, where you might expect there'll be a change in water structure as you approach the initiation of DNA replication and cell division and so on. So for that, you could perhaps consider using a synchronized population of bacteria.
Yes.
Have you envisaged doing that? And secondly, have you thought about using mutants? So that when you go into stationary phase, for example, you can have mutants which affect the entry to stationary phase.
Yes.
So you could begin to correlate the changes that you observe with the molecular players in the cell.
Yes.
Is that in your
thank you very
future,
much.
Near future?
Yes. Thank you. I think the task that we wanted to the problem to solve, to see what happens, is related to biotechnology. And also is a good example to show that it really is consistent and repeatable. And people working with bacteria can use it. Yes. Thank you.
Very exciting.
There's another question? Just one
just
more
one
question, very, very short. This is very interesting. So would you suggest or speculate that there is this inner intelligence, it could be trigger in DNA just based on the difference and how everybody responds different to the water, but at the same time there's this collectiveness intelligence that is maybe triggered by, it could be electromagnetic frequency that is a memory that maybe in the DNA that gets amplified as we replicate or multiply in the cellular level, and it gives me goosebumps. But what is your speculation with all these findings as far as life or how it works?
The question is a contradictory a little bit, I would say, because I don't think we have a finding yet. I don't think we have proven or we have measured in numbers such effect. I know that it is coming, and I know that people can do it, and this is what we're doing. We try to provide technology for people to use it and explore it. Yes, it's a huge, yes, thank you.
Okay, further questions? Ah, there is one.
I was very interested in the work you did with fullerenes. And in the States currently, there is a lot going on around fullerene oil and things like that. And then they say you can never use the artificial ones. You have to use the ones from nature, like from Shungit. I was just wondering which kind of fullerenes did you use? And if you tried different ones and saw a difference between them?
No, we didn't. We haven't tried different, but it's a good idea. Yeah.
There one last question, one short.
Now Jerry has a question. Yeah. But go ahead, yeah. And I can take both.
This is a question due to my own ignorance, which is vast. How did you, could you just say a few words about how you were able to establish the different molecular states? For example, each point on the aquagram represents a particular state. How do you know that?
Thank you for the question. I said a little bit in the beginning, but it wasn't clear. What we do is we follow the papers and the studies done in infrared spectroscopy with an assignment done in infrared spectroscopy with different water clusters and different water conformations. And we calculate overtones and we see consistency with our experimental data. And our experimental data is four-dimensional, means we take the spectra of the system over the time of different populations, many samples. So we have high variations. And the water bands that show these high variations usually are consistent with the assignment that we see in papers. And this is repeated in what I teach my students is, when you see a band in your experiment, you just calculate the main band and you go to and Google it. And then you get lots of papers going to the same protonated clusters or with three molecules or four or two or hydroxylated or different. It's always, it's fun. It is really very, very, very nice, yeah, to get the same results, yeah.
Hi there.
Hi.
Living in the north, and we're going to miss the sun dearly in a few weeks. Have you found out any either natural or artificial sources of near-infrared that you would think are comparable to sunlight?
Thank you for the wonderful question. This has been bothering me for a long time because I work in my lab, we have worked a lot with plants. And I know that all the artificial, especially in Japan, there are lots of new factories growing vegetables with blue light and red light. And one is to make plants grow fast and the other one is to make them big. And we did an experiment and the spectra are different. We can identify if the plant has been grown in the soil or in this artificial area, whatever it means. It bothers me, somebody has to do it, I don't know. But it's really, I think we have to, the sun, half of the sun is in infrared, and we have to provide it the same light, I think, yeah.
Okay, not to be too late for the second part. Thanks again, Rumiana.
Thank you.
And we're back for the coffee break.